Another problem of that same type. So what we have here is this. We have a cylinder on which a rod AB is resting. Okay, you may say that these are more theoretical problems, but towards the end we will also come with some reasonable practical examples. Okay, I will emphasize them. But these are very good conceptual problems to clear that how to solve these various type of problems. Now, a rod AB which is pinned at point A is resting on a cylinder. What we are given is that the weight, now this pounds, because I took this problem from Beer and Johnston, okay, it's in pounds multiplied by what, 2.2, I can convert to kg, but it's a huge pain. Okay, so just bear with me, pounds, kgs, it doesn't matter so long as you stick with the units. So the weight of the mass of this rod is 12 pounds, the dimensions are given in inches, okay. The mass of this cylinder is 36 pounds. And what we are told in this problem, that determine the largest magnitude of force P for which the assembly is stable or in equilibrium. And we are given that what is the point and line of action of force P. So we want to find out that if the force acts at this position, then what is the largest magnitude of force for which the assembly is in equilibrium? Any force larger than that, the equilibrium will be disturbed. What does that mean? That the slippage will happen at one or more surfaces and it will not be impending, it will be finite slippage, and then the entire assembly will just be destroyed. Okay, so can you tell me how do we attempt this problem? Okay, how many unknowns are there, how many equations do we have, and how do we take care of the slippages? Okay, how many unknowns do we have? At point A we have 2. Point of contact between the rod and the cylinder, we have 2. Bottom, we have 2. And load P is answer. So we have 7 unknowns. How many equations do we have? We have 6 equations, but we have 7 unknowns. So we need 1 slippage. How many surfaces do we have to slip? 2. Okay. So for example, if I give this problem to a reasonably average student who is doing this problem for the first time, the first gut reaction they will have is that they say, oh, the rod will slip out like this. So there is a slippage here and there is a slippage here. But is that the only way to create slippage? Okay, means for example, now let us think kinematically. This cylinder, if the entire assembly is to be disturbed by sliding the cylinder, the naive way or the simplest or the most boneheaded way you can think of is you just move this cylinder outside. Okay, just like this, so that there is a slippage here, there is slippage here. But is that the only way in which the slippage can happen? Cylinder may rotate. So the cylinder may roll about this point. Okay, what is rolling essentially? Rolling is essentially rotation plus translation. Okay, the cylinder may roll about this point. If it rolls about the bottom point, slippage happens at the top. If the cylinder rolls about the top point, slippage will happen at the bottom. And what we need to know now, that we understand the kinematics, but we want to figure out now that will the slippage happen at the top or will it happen at the bottom? And once we decide that, what is the effective force that is acting on the body? Is the point clear? Fine. Now note one thing, can we find out a normal reaction at the point of contact? Can we? Yes, easily, because we can take the top free body diagram, take moment about point A, the friction doesn't contribute because it passed through point A, so we'll get the normal reaction. Can we get a normal reaction at the bottom point? Yes, because that top normal reaction plus the weight will give us the bottom normal reaction. Now what we want to know is that, see, I have this general cautious policy that I don't want to commit to the direction of the friction force as much as possible. I want to wait till I am sure that the direction, because direction is such a dicey thing in these friction problems, that we really want to be sure that to the best of our abilities, if we can figure out the directions by looking at simple equilibrium, and then only say that friction at wherever slippage is equal to mu times n. So now by doing some basic mechanical analysis, can you tell me that for the bottom free body diagram, what should be the direction of friction? Should it be in this direction or should it be in the other direction? This or this? Will it be in the direction of P or will it be in the opposite to direction of P? Opposite. How do we know? Because we take the bottom free body diagram, take torque about the top contact point, we immediately know that for that to be balanced, okay, the friction direction has to be opposite to P. What about the top point? Will the direction of friction at the top point will be in the direction of P or opposite to the direction of P? Again opposite, because now we take torque for this free body diagram about the bottom contact point and we immediately know that for moment equilibrium or torque equilibrium, the direction should be opposite. So one thing is good. So we know the direction. That is one good thing. Now only thing that remains is to figure out if the slippage happens at the top point or it happens at the bottom point. This is the only thing we need to figure out. At top point you think? Why?
Center if you take, then it will be anti-clockwise. Means it will rotate that wheel at point of contact B in anti-clockwise direction.
No, but you cannot say that immediately, right? Because what you want to know, suppose think about it this way. If I give you a problem where the friction coefficient at the bottom was very, very low as compared to the top point, it may slip from the bottom.
Only visible force right now is P.
No, but you draw the free body diagram, so all forces become visible after that. Right? So what you are saying, the approach is fine. You want to think kinematically, but the final, you only need to find out what is the ratio, friction divided by normal reaction at the top, compared with the friction by the normal reaction at the bottom. And what you want is that they should be less than or equal to the coefficient of static friction for the assembly to be stable or it to be in impending stability. So what can we do? We know the directions of the frictions. We can just do one simple thing. Okay. So what we can do is that for this second free body diagram, taking torque about point C, we can obtain what is F2 exactly in terms of P, of course. Okay. Similarly, by sum of equilibrium of F1 and F2 should be equal to P. So we immediately know what is F1. Now we have already obtained, okay, previously that what are the normal reactions. So we have F1 by N1 and F2 by N2. Okay, so we get our ratios immediately, F1 by N1 and F2 by N2. And you can see that F1 by N1 ratio, okay, 0.0453, okay. So larger the ratio, okay, more chance of slippage, okay. So what we say is that we want our P in such a way that this quantity is equal to mu s, and that will give us the maximum value of P that can be applied. So just equate these two, that this top ratio is equal to mu s, so P will be equal to 7.72 pounds. Okay, this ratio is larger. So if ratio is larger, what do we need? That for stability, both should be less than or equal to mu s. But this is anyway, if this is less than or equal to mu s, this will automatically be less than or equal to mu s. So this is the critical point, and that critical point we invoke that this ratio is equal to mu s and P is equal to 7.72. So we tried our best to get all the directions properly and do it in such a way that friction is invoked as late as possible in this entire equation. Sometimes you have to invoke it early, like in the previous problems, but try to push it down as much as possible. Is the idea clear?
Force is acting at a point D.
Here?
Yes.
Okay, and so it's here also, yeah, force is acting at point P.
Yes, and that is the only force which causes the slip.
Yes, of course, if there is no P, no slip.
Yes, coefficient of friction at both the contact surfaces are same, right? Then moment produced by the force P at that bar, at a point B, is greater than moment produced by the same force at the contact surfaces. So due to that, we can say slip is there at that contact, upper one.
No. See, you can't. Because there are so many variables here. I will tell you one simple example that if we make this P go lower and lower, the friction at the bottom end becomes larger and larger. Okay? So what happens is that if you make it go to the exact bottom,
yes, that's what I'm telling you.
If exact bottom, then what is the friction force at the top?
Perpendicular distance is going to increase. Therefore, more moment is going to produce at the contact surfaces at B. Therefore, more slip is there at B as compared to lower.
No. It's exactly the other way around. If you make this point P, okay, keep going down and down, okay. So what you will see is that the friction at point B will keep decreasing. Because you note that if force P passes through the bottom, then by taking this equilibrium, what do we see? That there is no friction at the top. So there is no question of slippage.
No. Friction is there at both the contact surfaces, but
it is there. It can exist, and what is that value will depend on P.
Okay. We are going to find out where more slip is there.
Not where more slip is there. We are going to find out where is the possibility of impending slippage. It is not a question of more or less. It's a question of will it happen here before or will it happen here before?
Yes. That's what I'm telling. Na, that is its answer.
Miss, if you use the word more to mean that, then I agree with you.
Sir, yes. In this problem, we are applying P at eccentrically.
At what?
At eccentric, at not in the center.
Yes.
Whether the slip will happen or rotation of the cylinder will happen, sir.
Can you clarify what you mean that slip will happen or rotation will happen? Okay. What do you mean?
The slip means the both the bottom point and top point moving in the same direction, slip.
So there is a simple idea that it may so happen that both point at the top and the bottom may slip at the same time. But this is again a rule of thumb that if the system can be displaced from an equilibrium position by slipping at minimum surfaces, it will do that first. The slippage will try to happen as few surfaces as possible, which is compatible with the overall kinematics of the problem. And then you will see that mathematically also the same thing will be true. That a slippage at one surface, most likely there will be no slippage at other surfaces, only one surface, either top or the bottom, not both. And there may be certain values of weights and frictions where all the numbers conspire together in such a way that slippage is happening at both places. But a priori, you should never assume that it will happen at both places. We look mathematically what is happening. Mathematically, I know that I need only one equation extra. So I need to have slippage only at one point. Kinematically speaking also, you will realize that to get this assembly away from equilibrium, you don't need to move that complete cylinder. You need to just either move the top surface or the bottom surface. If both happens, it's a very special case. But a priori, it is not necessary. You cannot assume that like it is happening at two places. You do everything and it may turn out that some numbers conspire in such a way that it all happens like this also slips, this also slips. We can always find some numbers. You can do the back calculation such that the weight, you can back calculate the weight such that the two ratios F1 by N1 is equal to F2 by N2. But that's a very special case. More often than not, it will not happen.
Sir.
The cylinder rotates anticlockwise. F2 in the second figure should be rightward.
F2 in the? No. No, it can't be. Because take this. If this is an equilibrium, take torque about point D. This force is creating a torque what? In the anticlockwise direction?
Rotates in that clockwise. The cylinder will rotate in that clockwise.
In case of rotation, the direction of friction.
No. Take.
The slippage should not. Cylinder then rotates anticlockwise.
Huh.
Because it is eccentric load there. Because of the P. It has to rotate now instead of slipping, then F1 should be rightward.
No. Okay. If you take torque about point D, you got me confused. Okay, I got really scared for a second. Look at torque about point D. Torque about point D is in the clockwise direction. So to balance that torque, F2 has to be in the anticlockwise direction. So the direction has to be this. Note, take torque about point D. What is the torque about point D? I kept on thinking about the center and I got really scared. Okay, take a torque about point D. What is the torque? It's in the clockwise direction. Take torque of this force about point D. It has to be in the opposite direction. So this is to the direction.
Will it not rotate?
It will rotate about the center.
Okay, if it rotates about the center, it can do two things. It can both rotate and it can translate. So if I want to have slippage at point C and not at point D, what will you do? You will rotate it like this. Sorry, you will rotate it like this.
Hmm.
Okay, then what is happening is that this point is going here, okay?
Movement is in the anticlockwise direction then.
Wait a second. What is the question again?
Sir.
What is the question? Okay, I lost the question.
I want to answer his question.
No, you don't answer his question. I will answer the question, okay? If I can't, then you answer.
His question is appropriate if C is hinged. Your question is appropriate
no.
if C is hinged, but C is not hinged. So it is rotating about.
No, but what? Say, again, that's a very, very good point. What is friction providing? Friction providing a pseudo hinge. but it's a hinge where, for example, there are limits. In a hinge which we discussed in the last couple of classes, that hinge can provide any reactions in principle. But here, this is a very special hinge where it can provide both horizontal and vertical reaction, but only when F by N is less than or equal to mu s. So it is a hinge, of course. It is acting like a hinge, but a hinge has special properties.
Okay.
Okay, so you don't answer each other's question. Okay, let us go it through me.
This.
Okay. Any other questions?
This
so the directions are this only. There is no way you can have different directions. And in some problems, you will see that the directions are not a priori clear. But you can't help in those cases. But here, you know. And if we know, then we should make sure that the directions are appropriately put.
Sir, this is a sliding friction or a rolling friction?
No. See, rolling friction, if you look at any standard textbook, you will see that rolling friction ka technical definition is very different.
Different, yes.
So these are all sliding frictions. Let me put it this way.
So there
rolling is only what may happen. Rolling is, for example, rolling is a very layman term. What does rolling mean is that there is no slippage at a point of contact. But rolling friction is a loaded term. Okay, so you cannot use rolling friction. You can say that it is rolling, but ultimately friction is due to impending sliding.
Yes, so we are applying concept of a sliding friction.
Yeah, it's always sliding.
So there is no chance of a rotation, no opposite direction then. So you are true, sir. Yes, this is sliding friction only. Don't consider
sliding friction.
Yes.
There is no rolling friction has a very different connotation.
Yes.
Which? No. Ultimately what happens? See, what we are trying to do is this. We are trying to figure out that our mathematics tell us that we need only one equation, so slippage has to happen only at one point. And then we are trying to clarify our own thinking. We will try to think that what can be the possible impending motion. Now see, look here. If this is the direction of friction, okay, point C has to slide only in this direction. Okay, and how can that slide? But point D, there is no impending sliding. How can you achieve that? You can achieve that by having a rotation in the clockwise direction. What will that do about the center? This point C will move here. Listen, this point C will move here. This point D will move here. But we don't want any sliding at D. So then we translate the whole assembly. So it's a combination of rotation and translation, which will make this point slip here and this point D not go anywhere. And this point D slipping here, there's an impending slippage like this, which is consistent with the direction of friction that we have given there. So this kinematics is only for our understanding that, okay, that our mathematics is telling us something. Is our kinematics of the problem consistent with the mathematics of what we know? That we need slippage only at one point. Can we have a motion but an infinitesimal impending motion in such a way that it is consistent with the mathematics of the problem? And we will always find that it will happen.
Suppose in the same problem,
yes,
only the line of action of P is given.
Huh.
Direction is not given.
That's so a good point.
How to tackle the
yes.
problem?
Then the entire thing, you just turn everything the other way around.
So should we assume both directions and tackle?
But even in that case, what you will see is that the directions of frictions, we just slip.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, where is this?
Okay, I have a question. This side.
Yeah, please.
Sir, there is a point of this force P at D.
Okay, wait a second. What PD?
As I think, it should not slip. It should rotate only because there is a torque. It is acting at C, then okay, you are correct. But if there is any torque, so it should and there's a surfaces are rough or there is a friction between all these surfaces, then there must be a torque.
But when you say these things, what is the logic that you have in mind when you say such things? Okay, because you said it. Okay, but how do you know that is right? Or how do you convince yourself that what you are saying is actually right?
And one more thing is, here if it is slipping, then directions in free body diagram 2, it is correct. But in free body diagram 1, it may not be F1 in this direction. It should be also
equal and opposite.
In this direction.
No, equal and opposite. If F1 is this F1 and the other one, it should be opposite. There is no other choice.
Sir, if it is slipping only without rolling, I don't think that there should be any problem in deciding the direction of the forces. It will be always opposite. Why we are going for so much pain?
Wait a second. Okay, what is the pain and what we are going for? Okay, can you clarify again?
I am saying that if it is slipping only without rolling,
But you don't know that a priori. He is saying something and you are assuming what he is saying is right. Okay, it is not right.
No, sir, you said that we are assuming.
I did not say that. Okay, sorry. Okay, if I said that, okay, let me look at the video and then clarify it. But I did not, to the best of my knowledge. Okay, I did not. I said it will not slip in this problem at D. Only slippage will happen at C. And the way that can be achieved kinematically is that there is an overall rotation about the center followed by a translation such that this point D doesn't go anywhere, but point C slips in this direction. That's what I said.
Sir, I have a small doubt, sir.
Okay, I think one last question, okay.
Sir, if we apply the force P at point C exactly.
Point C exactly. Problem with the.
Both top and bottom surfaces will have equal chance of slipping.
Not equal chances. Why? Because the friction forces will be the same at top and bottom, but the normal reactions are different.
Sir, as far as the beam AB is concerned, no?
What?
The beam AB is concerned. Yeah. That is the top point.
Yes.
That is contact point C. Contact, of the roller,
you are center,
saying.
Center C. This contact point C in this, okay, I screwed up, okay.
Let's refer to that. Yeah. The normal load which is coming is only R1.
Is only?
R1.
R1, yeah.
Yeah, and the frictional force is F1, okay. And your, the torque which is applied, that is P into the eccentricity, what you have, no?
Okay.
That is also in the anticlockwise direction.
Yeah.
And
listen, is the anticlockwise direction about which point? But we have to talk about at which point.
About C.
Okay, anticlockwise.
Yeah. Therefore, that is rotating like this.
I have to clarify. I have to step in here. It is not rotating. There can be an impending rotation. Okay, there is a big difference when you say this.
Yes.
Yeah.
The possible thing is there is anticlockwise rotation.
It's an infinitesimal impending rotation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And thereby, the normal reaction is that the frictional force is there. And this movement now is also adding to that frictional rotation.
Okay.
Okay. Whereas when you're coming to the bottom contact point here, the total normal load is which is acting as the R1 plus the weight of the disc.
Yes.
The normal reaction is much more.
Yes.
Therefore, the frictional resistance which is generated at the bottom point is
higher.
Higher.
Yes.
When compared to the frictional force which is developed only because of the weight of the beam.
Yes.
That is one point to be considered.
Yes.
And in addition to that, you are rotating it. When you rotate it, the frictional resistance may come down at the bottom, but the weights which suggest they are less.
Yes. You are right. So that's the point I'm making. But the numbers are conspired in such a way a priori without putting in the numbers. You cannot say that the normal reaction is larger at the bottom, so it is stable there. No, because this is down, so the friction also is larger here. So it has to be a ratio that you should look at. Okay, so I think we should, no. Any questions, any doubts after this, okay? So I have to finish one last problem. Okay, no, after this. Okay, let me quickly finish this. So what we have here is a very well-known problem, okay, which we face in our day-to-day life, is that we have a cupboard or we have, for example, this, which I don't know why I would want to slide this, but suppose if I wish to, okay? So what we have here is that, so we have an extended body, okay, of weight W, it's in contact with the ground, and you're asked to find out that if the width of this is B, then what should be the maximum height at which I can apply it, okay, a load P? Okay, what is the maximum height at which we can apply a load P such that this thing, this entire assembly, okay, will not topple? Because generally what happens is that if you realize that, for example, you are trying to move a cupboard, okay, or somebody is trying to move a cupboard, you are trying to watch or help him, whatever way, you see that if you push on the top, the thing tends to topple. Okay, so many times what you do is that you like try to push it from the bottom, okay, or like lie down and push with your legs. So the question asked here is that given all these dimensions, okay, it's a very simple problem, how do you find out what is the maximum height at which this load should act such that this system does not topple? Okay? Now, when we say something topples, okay, friction will arise at what? So friction arises at what? At a corner point. So what we look at is we want that something is about to topple. Okay? So two things can happen. Huh? Perfect. The total reaction, the point at which the reaction acts is what we are trying to find out. For example, many times we made a point that the reaction point will adjust such that torque balance is obeyed. But in some cases, especially when the bodies are big, that need not be always achievable. Okay, so in this case, what we want is that the line of action will pass through some point. If you increase the height at which the load is applied, it will keep shifting. And when it reaches the edge, okay, is when the thing is about to topple. But you will also realize that if the friction is very low, okay, if the friction is very low, then before toppling, it will actually slide. Okay, so the competition is between toppling and sliding. So it may, for example, go all the way, okay, on the edge, but still, when you are pushing on it, it need not topple. It may start to slide. Okay, the moment you apply any load, okay, so it may start to slide. And what we are asked here is that given the coefficient of friction between the bottom and this cupboard or what are on this block, what is the maximum height such that it topples before it slips? Is the question. Is the point clear? That even when you think that it is about to topple, it may just start sliding. Okay? So what is the how do you solve this problem? It can be solved in actually one line if you just realize that this is a three-body member, okay, which is a much maligned three-body member. That this is the weight acting to the center line. All the reactions are concentrated at the edge because it is about to topple. And what we want to understand is, will it slip? Will it topple before it's slipping or not? So then what we do is this. Okay, this is N. This is the effective reaction. This is the angle between N and F. This is the line of action of force P, H. What we want is that for that body to be in equilibrium, we want all of this complete reaction, weight and P should meet at one point. Now what we see is this, that if we increase this theta, okay, if we increase this, if we decrease this theta, then height keeps increasing, right? If we keep increasing this theta, then this height will also keep increasing. But what is the maximum value of the, what is the maximum value of theta that you can have? No, corner reaction can't be zero, otherwise there will be no balance, because we know that F should be equal to P, N should be equal to W. Okay, so it will be just, what we just find out is that tan theta will be equal to, by definition, okay, by geometry, is equal to B by 2H. Okay, but what we also realize is that there is a limitation on this, that tan theta come maximum value can be mu, because we want to increase this H as much as possible. Okay, that we want that, for example, that what is the maximum height we can go to such that before slipping, it tips. Okay, and so that what we do is that tan theta will be equal to mu, and so H is equal to B by 2 mu. Anytime you increase the height above that value, then it may tend to topple, but it will actually slide. Okay, it may actually tend to topple, but it will really slide. Okay, so that is the entire idea. And if the value of height, okay, is less than that value, then it will topple first before sliding. And the only thing what we realize is that if the height h, okay, is suppose the height h is somewhere here, okay, somewhere lower at the through the center. Okay, then what do we realize is then the impending slippage, okay, that impending slippage will guarantee that this is theta is equal to phi s, and we will see that the corresponding line of contact or the point where this force acts will be simply given by mu h by 2 by simple geometry. Theta is remaining same because we are looking at the impending slippage also, the theta will be equal to phi s. So the question is this, that we are trying to move this. So when we are trying to move this, there has to be, we are trying to do two things. It can either topple or it can have an impending slippage. So what we are just saying is that if the height is less than the critical height, then there will be no tipping or there will be no toppling. But we still want to exert enough force that there is still impending slippage because we want to slide this entire thing. But then we turn the question around and ask ourselves that in this case, can you tell me when the impending slippage is about to happen, what is the point at which the effective reaction acts, and that you get from here, that when the impending slippage is about to happen. So problem number 8 is a reasonably interesting problem. It seems very formidable, but actually it's very straightforward. And the idea is as follows. So if you have already read the statement of the problem, okay, then maybe this is a repetition. But what we have here is that there is a central hinge, and we have this device where this central wheel can rotate in the clockwise direction, okay, by an internal torque. This is connected to some motor, for example, which is providing it a torque in the clockwise direction. And this device, okay, is, for example, is any torque that is being applied to it, these two small spheres or these two small cylinders, they are preventing rotation of this when that torque M is applied. Okay? These two small rollers have a contact point here and here, a contact point here and here. So this entire assembly has a 180 degree rotational symmetry. If you take this and rotate by 180 degrees, you will get exactly the same device. And what we are asked to find out that if there is a common coefficient of static friction between this point, and this point, there are four contact points, then what is the range of D? If you can see, what is D? D is the distance between the wall and the center, okay, such that the device will operate, okay, as desired. What does that mean? Is that the braking mechanism can be provided by this. We want a range of values of D when this can happen. Now, when you think about it, we have put our problems in various categories. Okay, category 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is a very peculiar problem. How many unknowns do you think are present in this problem? So there is, if I look at the lower cylinder, then there are two unknowns here, two unknowns here, 2 to 4, okay, 5, 6, 7, 8. At this point, how many? 9, 10, two reactions plus the unknown torque. There is also a torque that is present, okay, 11. So we have 11 unknowns, and how many free body diagrams can we draw? 3. So 3 free body diagrams, so 9. So we still need two extra equations, okay? But the point is this, you will realize something funny very soon, okay? So we need two extra equations, which means that we need slippage at two points, okay? But can you tell me now, is there anything special about this cylinder? What is asked here is that neglect the weight of these two rollers, okay, roller or cylinder. So neglect the weight of this, neglect the weight of this. So if we neglect the weight of this one and this one, can we simplify the problem by this assumption? Or let me put it this way, that the forces that are involved in this problem are much larger, the contact forces will be much larger compared to the weight, so we neglect it. So this fact that we can neglect the weight of the two rollers, can that simplify our problem? Or what can we say about the rollers then, or their reactions? Symmetry though is there. So whatever happens at the top, same thing will happen at the bottom. Okay, that symmetry is present. There is a 180 degree symmetry. You rotate the entire assembly by 180, you get the same thing. Okay, so you immediately know that symmetry is present. But if we neglect the weight of the rollers, then what can we say about the reactions at this point and at this point? There will be normal, there will be friction. But just think about it. The reactions are happening where? Only at the ends? The reactions are happening, are acting only at the edges. Two points, the contact point. There are two contact points, so the reactions are acting exactly at two contact points. What can you say about those two? They're two force members. Okay, so there are two force members, and if there are two force members, then what do we know? We know that if we have a line joining this point with this point, that will be the line of action of the reaction. Do you agree with me? Okay, so that will be the line of action of this reaction. Same for this. But then can you tell me that why do we need to have a requirement on D? That why can't D become smaller than a particular value? What is the maximum possible value of D? Can you tell me? R plus, capital R plus 2R, that is the maximum value of D you can have. But why is there a requirement for a minimum value? Why do you think? So what we figured out is this, that it is a seemingly complicated problem, but we are asked to find out what is the range of D. We could kind of guess, okay, that the largest value of D by geometry, can be capital R plus 2 times small r. But then the question is demanding that there is also a small, there is a lower limit on D. And lower limit of D is a geometric quantity. We know that the line of action of this force is purely governed by the geometry. This point and this point you join. Okay? So in this case, what will happen is if you draw this free body diagram, so this is the point of contact. Okay? If this is the point of contact, then you will see that no weight, two force member, so this should be the line of action of the two reactions. Now, if I zoom this in, what will I see? Look at the top cylinder here. Just look at the top cylinder. I zoom here. This is the larger cylinder, the larger wheel. This is the smaller cylinder. Line of action is from here to here. Suppose this angle is phi. This angle also has to be phi, and this angle will be 2 phi. Then what will be the distance? Distance will be small r plus capital R cos 2 phi plus small r. Do you agree with this statement? That small, that the distance, okay, this distance is nothing but join the, is nothing but take this line, join center to center, okay? So it is r plus r, this is phi phi 2 phi, r plus r cos 2 phi plus small r. So this horizontal distance is capital R plus small r cos 2 phi plus small r. Do you agree with me if I say that this is the distance d? Yes? Now the question is that why is there a minimum requirement on d? If phi increases, what happens to d? If this angle phi, you see, do you realize what is this angle phi? This angle phi is nothing, okay, but the angle made with respect to horizontal by the point joining this contact and this contact, by the line joining these two contact points. What happens if phi increases? Phi increases, cos phi decreases, d decreases. Okay? If we make d very small, okay, very, very, very small, what is the implication on this cos 2 phi? No, no, it's not a question of normal reaction here. Just think in terms of this angle. Just think of this angle that if you decrease d, what happens to this angle? This angle keeps increasing. Okay, this angle phi keeps increasing because larger the phi, smaller is cos 2 phi and smaller will be d. So if you keep decreasing d, angle phi will increase. But we know the coefficient of static friction between all the contacts. So what is the maximum value you can have of that angle phi? Tan inverse mu. Tan inverse mu is the maximum value you can have for that angle. So what does that mean? That any value of angle, when it becomes larger, d becomes smaller, but you cannot exceed that angle while at the same time keeping the system in equilibrium. So that immediately tells you that there has to be a lower limit and your d cannot become smaller than that, because if your d becomes smaller than that, your phi increases, and it increases beyond tan inverse of mu, which will make the system not be in equilibrium. So that immediately gives you phi, maximum value is phi s, you substitute that, and you will immediately see that d min will come out to be this simple expression. And d max is good. It's 2r plus small r, and that phi requirement is automatically satisfied because phi is equal to 0, which is less than tan inverse of mu, so you are good. So the maximum limit is when d is equal to capital R plus 2r, and the small limit is governed by this requirement when this angle phi becomes equal to phi s. So what we have done is that this seemingly formidable problem, just by recognizing that these two wheels are two force members and by invoking angle of friction, we could solve this problem in essentially three lines. Okay, so in the beginning, I had said that I had my own doubts about like what is the need for that extra angle of friction. Okay, we have mu, we have F, we have normal reaction, let's work with it. But what we see here is that geometry, when used appropriately, can be extremely helpful, as is seen in this problem. Any question you have with this problem? Any question with the solution? There is one interesting point that I'm to make after this, but do you have any other question or any doubt? Which two rollers?
Big and small
roller. Okay, so you're talking about this friction? This?
Ah,
and
yes,
this.
In between two rollers.
In between? How do you have, they are not in contact with each other, right? There is one roller here, one roller here. Or the wheel and the roller. Okay, so wheel and the roller, there is clearly friction. Now just look here. This R is making an angle with respect to normal reaction. Just look here. This is R, this is the normal. The line joining the centers of these two will be normal. Okay, so this R will have some angle, so clearly there is a friction force. Right? R times sine phi will be the friction force. Because this angle is phi, this angle is also phi, so R sine phi will be this friction force. And note one thing, what is the question of this problem? That this device is used to prevent clockwise. Are the friction directions consistent with that? Think about it, are the directions of friction consistent with this? What is the reaction we are, what is the reaction that will act here on this wheel? Like this, okay? This is the reaction which is provided by the wheel on the roller which is outwards. So what is the reaction that the roller provides on the wheel is in this direction, okay? What is the direction of friction? Direction of friction will be upwards. What kind of torque it will provide? Counterclockwise torque, same for the bottom one, and there will be two counterclockwise torques that will be provided by the friction force, and they will resist the clockwise rotation. And note that the geometry of this assembly is such that the friction can only be provided in the clockwise direction, sorry, in the anti-clockwise direction. So if you try to rotate this assembly, okay, in the other direction or in the anti-clockwise direction, it will fail. It will not do that. So in order to do, we need two wheels provided here and here, okay? So because we want a rotation in this direction, it is, that's why we have chosen that this should be the orientation of the wheels. Is the point clear? This one? Now another question. You solve this problem fully, you will realize that there is no way in the world you can obtain the normal reaction. You can only get that all the ratios are fine, but the actual values of normal reaction and the friction will not be obtainable from this problem. It's not possible. So what do you think may be happening? You solve this problem, you will never be able, it's a statically indeterminate problem where you know that this assembly is good, that it can provide me the requisite friction. But what it doesn't tell you that what is the maximum torque that it can balance. All it tells you is that with that distances, it is good to go. But what it doesn't tell you is what is the moment carrying capacity. Why? Because if you solve this problem, the normal reactions will never come. So what may be happening here? How do you decide what is the torque carrying capacity? Because we have not talked about that, how much moment you try to rotate it within the clockwise direction will be balanced by this assembly. How do you decide that? Any guess? So typically what will happen in this case is that these two wheels, they will be pre-stressed, they will be compressed and then put inside. And so they will try to expand, and depending on how much pre-stress you have given in those wheels, that normal reaction will appropriately increase. And so that becomes a problem in solid mechanics now, in conjunction with this simple engineering mechanics. And the amount of pre-stress, the stiffness of the wheels, the stiffness of the cylinders will decide what is the normal reaction that will be generated. And that in turn will decide that what is the maximum moment or what's the maximum torque that this assembly can provide a counterbalance to. Is the idea clear? Okay, so that problem is statically indeterminate. It's not a topic of EMEC, but note that the question that is asked, that what is the maximum value or minimum value of D, that is still solvable by using simple arguments. But we cannot solve everything here. So that's why I said ki there were categories, 1, 2, 3, 4, but always, those are rules of thumb, you can always have funny problems, okay, which doesn't fit any category. Is the idea clear behind this? Very simple mechanism, but a geometry, once you look at a geometry, okay, that immediately simplifies the problem so that you can, like this formidable looking problem, so called, can even be solved in just 3 or 4 lines. Any doubts, any questions? Okay.
What about the friction force of the lower one?
It will be symmetric to the top one. Just look, now there's a 180 degree symmetry.
That is symmetrical, but when
we are
considering
this
bias?
What bias?
Phi maximum you have considered tan inverse mu s.
Same thing will happen at the bottom because this assembly is maintained in a symmetric way.
That is true, sir. I agree.
Yeah.
Only my suppose one more roller has been added, so there is no effect.
Is added. Okay. Alert. Then the problem becomes it won't be solvable by simple EMEC ideas. Will it be or won't it be? It will still be solvable. Okay? Only thing what will happen
essence,
is that...
It is nothing to do with the number of...
But in that case, what will happen is that because now here, because of the symmetry, this D you decide, that D is also automatically decide. But if you add one more, then it's a funny thing. But the point is that you add a redundant roller because these are good enough, both of them.
What
the redundant roller, you have to just decide ki what is the top roller will give you some D, bottom roller will give you some D. Okay, depending on what roller you want to be functional, you may have to choose between maximum or minimum. Okay, but adding one more roller, you can still get the angles, but there is no unambiguous answer for D. Because there is a D coming from the top roller, D coming from the bottom roller. So the problem becomes a bit ill-conceived. Okay, because there are two lengths now that will be involved if you put a roller on the top also. Okay, some other third roller if you add, then the number of lengths that are involved are more. Then it will all boil down to what length you are interested in.
My concern is about the frictional force. So
yeah, frictional force will still come, na? But if you put a roller...
If the number of rollers are gone increasing, that total force will be more. Opposite force or a frictional force.
Yeah, so?
So here, is it that tan inverse mu s will be holds good if...
No. See, this problem is just telling you that there will be some angle phi which depends on this distance. And what we only want is that phi should not exceed phi s. That is the only requirement we need. But we also saw that the distance d is also related to phi a. And so we say that, for example, that we don't want phi to go beyond a certain value, which automatically implies that d should not go below a certain value. If you add one more roller, some other length will come. But these phi arguments, everything will remain the same because all of them still will be two force members. But then the point is that what is the definition of d? Like, do you look at d of the third roller? So it is a little bit of a, ill-conditioned problem. But what this is telling you that this assembly is sufficient, and at least as far as the minimum distance is concerned, we can tell from simple engineering mechanics principle that there is a minimum distance and the largest distance governed simple by the 2r plus r, the overall dimensions of the assembly. Yes? So let us move on. So this problem, okay, is a very interesting problem, okay, so it will involve a lot of some geometrical thinking. And at the same time, okay, like how do we decide what are the contact surfaces, where the slippage will occur, how to do that analysis, most of the things will be taken care of in this problem. And in the tea break, some of you came to me asking like some clarifications, and I realized that I made some statements, okay, which were not wrong, but they have the potential to be interpreted in such a way that can create further confusion. So let me clarify those points also at the same time while we are solving the problem. So problem definition is straightforward, like most problem in engineering mechanics. What we have is two cylinders, okay, are on an inclined plane with angle 15 degrees. The coefficient of friction at all the contacting surfaces, 1, 2, and 3, is 0.2. Weight of each of the cylinder is 30 pounds. Okay, pounds I took it from Beer and Johnson old book. Everything is in pounds. Not Beer and Johnson. This is a Merriam problem. 1972 edition, everything is in pounds. So 30 pounds, what we are asked to find out is minimum force P required to move the two identical cylinders up the incline. So it is like, for example, you have seen that there are like people like you are carrying barrels up the slope. Okay, it's a small slope, but if you are carrying two barrels at the same time, pushing them up, then given the dimensions, given the frictional properties between all contact points, you're asked to find out what is the minimum force P required so that the assembly just starts to move upwards. Is the problem statement clear? Fine. So now how many unknowns are present in this problem? Before you even go to the solution slide, what are the number of unknowns? So 7 unknowns, okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, P. P is also an unknown because we need to find out that P. Okay, if there is no P, what happens? P is 0. Entire assembly rolls down. So what we need to do is we need to apply some bare minimum force P to prevent it from coming down. But in addition, we need to provide even extra force P so that the assembly starts to move up. Okay, so here the problem definition is very important that we want that P minimum such that the assembly starts impending motion upwards. So there are 7 equations. How many free body diagrams? 2. So 6 equations, 7 unknowns. So we need slip at exactly one plane, okay? But there are 3 surfaces now. Till now, all the problems we had discussed, okay, the slippage, like there were two competing surfaces, and we decided, okay, it will happen here or here. But in this problem, there are three competing surfaces. Now, how do we decide where the slip will happen? To do that, first we need to figure out when those two cylinders are trying to move up, how do you think they will, like, how will the impending motion be? Now, this is one point I want to emphasize again, that while solving that rod and the cylinder problem, I kept on saying that a cylinder can roll and slip. So some of you kind of misinterpreted saying that rolling means rolling friction. So there is no rolling friction here. If you go and look at any standard textbook, rolling friction has a very, very different connotation. No rolling friction. We are all talking about slips, okay? That if this is going to slip, other going to slip. All those kinematic ideas, when I say kinematics, that how the system is going to be disturbed by a small motion, by impending, a small impending motion. We are just trying to visualize that what can be a small geometric motion that is compatible, okay, with the given statement of the problem is what we are trying to do. Okay, so when I say all those diagrams, that rotation and translation, it is not like huge translation and rotation. It's an impending kinematics that when the system is now is in equilibrium, it is just disturbed from the equilibrium position. Then what is the kind of motion, like tiny infinitesimal motions that can happen to the system so that they are compatible or they are consistent with the overall definition of the problem. Now, as you will see in this problem, that visualizing how this system can go up can make our life very easy to understand what will be the directions of friction. In the problem for the cylinder problem, just by doing simple moment equilibrium, we could find direction of friction immediately, okay, without making any assumptions. We could get the direction of friction, and it could be only this. But in this problem, okay, because there are so many surfaces, we want to first understand what do we mean when this assembly, like what may happen kinematically when this entire assembly is trying to go up the slope. Okay, some thoughts. So how do you think this assembly, when you push up, how do you think will this go up the slope? In a very infinitesimal sense, okay, not like just rolling up, very infinitesimal motion, just about to start. How will it happen? Some thoughts? Both cylinders, how will they move? What do you think, will they rotate or will they translate? What will happen, do you think?
Without any rotation, both cylinders will translate along that surface.
Okay, now if both of them move upwards, slip is happening where? Slip is happening both for the bottom point and the top point. Right?
Bottom.
No. If the both cylinders move upwards, slip is happening at the top also.
At contact surface between two cylinders, there will be slip.
No. You are saying that both cylinders, without any rotation, they can just move, just translate upwards.
Yes.
But if that happens, then you have a slip at the bottom cylinder also, at the top cylinder also. We need only one slip. But then it can't happen. You can't just have, like, slide both of them upwards and only slip happens at the bottom. It can't happen. It's not feasible. Right? It is not feasible. That's the reason why we want to think little bit in terms of like how that impending motion can happen. One way it happens is that both of them slide upwards. But if they both of them slide upwards, you have two frictions. Okay, that is not compatible with the mathematics. We need only one slip. Now, one motion can happen is this. Both of them, okay, can do this. Okay, so let me open this new slide. So both going, see, that is the thing which, for example, you tell students immediately, say, okay, both of them slide upwards. But then you are getting two slips. You see my point? But the mathematics is telling you that I have seven unknowns. I have six equations. I need only one slip. Okay, and there is a law, a very law of nature, okay, which I have found out, okay. It's a very hand-waving thumb, okay, no law. But if the motion can happen with as few slips as possible, as opposed to having multiple slips, more slips, it will try to follow that course where the number of slips will be as less as possible. Now, you
sir,
can think here. Yes, please.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Okay, sir. So, yeah, we are applying torque only on rear wheel.
See, right now there is no...
And
see,
at that time we have discussed that there would be no friction at front wheel.
But the reason for that was that the front wheel was rotating at a uniform angular velocity about an axle which we believed was well lubricated, so it could not provide an internal torque. And that was the reason which guaranteed us, okay, not going into details about, like, as one professor pointed out, that the point contact, there is some deformation. Okay, assuming that, like, the cycle, very high pressure in the cycle, and there is very little, it's a point contact. Okay, so that problem and this problem, first of all, let me emphasize, they are drastically different. Okay, they are drastically different. Why? Because there were hinges internally. Okay, those conditions also had to be satisfied. Second of all, there the bicycle was moving uniformly upwards at a constant speed. Here, it's stationary. We want to apply enough force such that there is an impending motion just happening, just an impending motion. Okay, so they are not the same at all. Now, what we are trying to understand, okay, is how that impending motion can happen. And what I'm saying is that it is not mandatory. But if we can think about the impending motion in some different ways, we can really, really get a deeper insight into the problem, okay? And can also, for example, like as we can see in this problem, we can immediately fix what is the direction of the friction forces. So if I come here, okay, so let us have a look at this. What is the motion that can happen? That the first wheel, okay, first wheel, infinitesimal rotation about the center plus translation. Infinitesimal rotation of the second wheel about the center plus translation. How much rotation, how much translation says that 0.1 and 0.3, there is no slip. Pure translation, what will it do? It will create a slip here, but if you add a small rotation, then what happens is that there is no slip here because we can compensate for that distance moved. Think about it, fine? And again, this is only infinitesimal, and this, now where can the slip happen then? Look at this point. This point will move downward coming from the first cylinder, will move upwards coming from the other cylinder. So how will that motion be? This will try to go down, this will try to go up. Okay, it's like gear. It is trying to go up and down. So there is a slip there. This is the first mode in which the slip can happen. Second mode, what happening here is that the first cylinder has a tiny infinitesimal translation followed by rotation in the anticlockwise direction. Now what does that imply? This point will slip, clearly. But this point, if it has a same amount of rotation in the opposite direction, followed by translation, then note that this point, we can still make this entire cylinder go up, okay, this two assembly. Okay, note here that with this motion, the entire assembly can go up. With this motion also, very infinitesimal motion, the entire assembly can move a little bit upwards. But the slip now cannot happen here because both of them rotate in the same way, okay, same magnitude, so no slip. So only slip can happen here. Finally, the third mode in which that entire assembly can move upwards is that this one has translation and rotation, so that no slip here, equal and opposite rotation, so no slip here, but a combination of sliding and translation, or sliding and some rotation, which will provide a slip here. So these are the three different ways in which this entire assembly can infinitely move upwards while having slipping only at one surface. Okay? And note one thing immediately, that with all of these motions, friction direction can only be this. If this slippage happened here, how can friction be? This is trying to go down, going up. So friction on this one can only be down, and the other one can only be up. Think about it. It is trying to do this. Friction on this is up. Friction on the other cylinder is down. Okay? And once this is up and down, if you look at this cylinder, taking torque about the center, taking moment about the center, if this is F, F has to be only, F at this point can have the, has to have the same magnitude and this direction. There is no other choice. Same here. If this is F, this friction also has to be F, and the direction has to be downwards. There is no choice. Mechanics will give you no choice. It will fix that. And no matter what mode does the body slip, okay, what mode does the body go upwards by, you will see that you will put all the friction forces. For example, if the friction, if the body slides upwards in this mode, okay, you will see that the friction only can go downwards because this point is going upwards. So whatever you do, you will immediately see that this has to be your free body diagram with these as the forces, and all the friction forces have to be equal. So the idea behind all this thinking is that we could figure out what is the direction of friction, what is the magnitude also, like we say that all the friction should be equal, and this becomes our simplified free body diagram. If you don't do this kind of analysis, then how do we interpret? What do we mean by two of the cylinder going up? Okay, what is the direction of slippage? Okay, where can it happen? But with this analysis, we immediately know that the assembly going up, it can go up by slipping exactly at one surface, and no matter in what mode it slips, the friction, the free body diagram will only like this, with the direction of frictions only like that. There is no other choice. Okay, so that's the reason. For example, in this case, it was helpful to understand what does it mean that the assembly is going up, because we could fix the direction of all the frictions. Okay? Now it is straightforward. Once we know that these are the directions, if this is F, taking torque about or taking moment about point W, we know that this has to be F in this direction because this is creating an anticlockwise torque, clockwise torque, FF. This is a create for this free body diagram. All other forces pass through the center, but what we know is that if this is F, this is F. Okay, the moment if this is F, it is creating a torque in the anticlockwise direction. So the second F has to create a torque in this direction. Okay, and both of them will be equal. Then what you can do is that for the second free body diagram. Now we have to figure out that frictions at all the points A, B, and C are the same. Now how do we decide where does the slip occur? We don't know still. But what we know is that the coefficient of friction at all the points is same and equal to 0.2. So the point where the slippage will happen the first will be the point where the normal reaction is the lowest. Okay? Lowest normal reaction will give you the slippage. Now let us look at the top free body diagram. Look how the free body diagram looks like. Note, this is one tangent. This is another tangent along the slope. They intersect at point D. Now for this free body diagram, if we take moment balance about this point D, what do we see? That normal reaction N2 times radius plus W times some D, some distance, will be equal to normal reaction 3, okay, times R. We are taking moment about this point D for the entire free body diagram. And from this simple equation, you will see that since D is greater than 0, just do some geometric visualization and you will see that when angle theta, the slope angle, is less than 45 degrees, then this D will always be greater than 0, and you will see that N3 is always greater than N2. So there is no possibility of slippage at point 3. Then you have to only compete between point 1 and point 2. Now, how do we compete between point 1 and point 2? Just write down the free body equation. You will see that the equation for N2, okay, draw the free body diagram for this. Equilibrium in the vertical direction will give equation for N1. Equilibrium for this free body diagram, okay, equilibrium along x direction will give you this equation. So now we still don't know that N2, N1, F, W sin theta. We don't know if N1 is more than N2. Now at this stage, when we cannot do anything further, okay, now like whatever analysis we do, this equation still remains and there is no way to know if N2 is more than N1. Now we bite the bullet finally and say, ki, let us assume that the friction happens at point 2. Now you can as well assume that friction happens at point 1. But if you assume that the friction happens at point 2, then friction force F will be written as mu times N2. Just substitute here, solve these equations, you will get that this is the value of N1, this is the value of N2. And what you will see is that N1 is equal to 0.9W, putting in all the values, and N2 is equal to 0.324W. And our assumption was that the slippage is happening at 0.2 was consistent. Why? Because the normal reaction at 1 is coming out to be more than the normal reaction at 2, which is what we had assumed to begin with. So the friction will happen first at 2 and then at 1. Substitute all the values and you will immediately see that if I draw the complete free body diagram, 1 plus 2, then for balance of forces along x, you will see that P, which is this force, will be equal to 2W sine theta plus 2 times this friction force, and put friction force equal to 2 mu s times N2. You will see that what is the minimum force required to have an impending motion for these two cylinders up the slope. So what we have done is that we don't want to commit, okay, to where the slippage is happening till the very end. We want to obtain the directions as unambiguously as possible and try to obtain where the slippage can happen as unambiguously as possible. For example, our analysis told us that N3 is more than N2, so slippage cannot happen at 3. But as far as N1 and N2 are concerned, we could not say anything. And as you will see that, for example, for certain values of slopes and for certain values of coefficient of friction, you plug in the values and you will actually see that N1 will turn out to be lesser than N2, and so the slippage will happen at N1 and not N2. Okay? So that tells you that, for example, there is no way by simple mechanics you can figure out where the slippage can happen. At the end, you just decide, okay, let me say that the slippage is happening at point 2. Now let us see what is the reaction. Is N1 more than N2 or N2 more than N1? If N1 turns out to be more than N2, which it happened here, then our assumption that slippage happens at 2 and not at 1 is good. If not, we just repeat the entire procedure in the other way around, say that the slippage happens at 1. So the friction force is equal to mu times N1, solve the other problem and it will work. Okay, so this is like a very comprehensive problem. okay, where, for example, visualization, proper choice of free body diagrams, proper choice of equilibrium equations will really simplify your life, okay, and make the solution procedure more logical and less prone to errors. Okay, so with this, if you have any questions, you can ask, or else we can start the tutorial. Yes, please. Somebody has a question?
Yeah, if you take the second case, that is rolling anti-clockwise.
Okay, the second the from the top.
Direction of friction should be in the opposite direction.
Which one? No.
Second case.
Second, yeah. In the middle, right?
Yeah, middle one.
Just note one thing.
If it is moving anti-clockwise.
No. If it is moving anti-clockwise, look, how does the point B, the downward point, where I have put those two lines, how will that move? Is it going to move upwards or downwards? Think.
It will slip like this.
So if just by the rotation, will it move up or down? The bottom point where I have drawn those two green lines, that is where the slip is happening.
Yeah.
You tell me that if there is only rotation, tiny rotation, that point of contact, will it move up or down?
No rotation.
It will move now because rotation about the center, what is happening? If you rotate about this point is going to move upwards. And there is, in addition, there is an arrow which is going upwards. So the overall movement, infinitesimal movement of that bottom point will be upwards. So the relative sliding is upwards, friction force has to act downwards.
No, I'm not talking about point B.
Which point are you talking about?
Second case, point B. Friction at point B.
Oh, friction at point B, you cannot say anything. From this diagram, you cannot say anything, but you draw the free body diagram, then for the balance of moment of that point, because there is no impending motion now. At the center point, look here, if both of them rotate like this, these points are not slipping.
Yeah.
But not having an impending motion doesn't mean that friction cannot exist. Impending motion is the extreme case of slippage. Extreme case of friction is impending motion, where you know that friction is equal to mu times the normal reaction. So that point, we cannot say anything just by looking at that diagram, because there is no impending motion. But if I know that the impending motion is happening downwards, we know that the direction of friction is downwards, and now look at that free body diagram. The only direction of the friction at point B can be upwards, because if you want to have moment equilibrium of free body 1 about the center, then it is mandatory that if the bottom one is F and downwards, then the top one will be F and upwards. It is mandatory. Now mechanics guarantees that both will be F and the direction will be this.
No, that is, I am talking about in the first wall point B, if it is rotating anti-clockwise like this, then the friction should be downward.
No, that's what I am saying. It is, but the point is that, is there any impending motion happen at the contact point B in this case? You are talking about the middle case, right?
Yeah.
About this.
Yeah.
Is there any impending motion happening at the middle point? You tell me. If the two rotations are same, infinitesimal rotation, the anti-clockwise rotation, suppose it is delta omega, the clockwise rotation is delta omega. Is there any slip that is happening at those two points? No. Then you cannot say anything about what is the direction of friction there immediately. You cannot. Only when there is an impending slippage, where you see that there is a relative sliding, can you immediately say that the direction of friction has to be this. But if there is no impending slippage, a priori there is no way of saying that the friction is up or down, because there is no relative slippage. But that doesn't mean there is no friction. There can be friction, and the direction now will be fixed by mechanics. If you have more questions, you can ask me afterwards. But I think I made it very clear here. That not having relative motion doesn't mean there is no friction. And if the two, for example, if two bodies are moving together, there can be friction. Only thing is that we cannot talk about the direction immediately. We cannot.